Welcome back to the third Kali Linux episode. Let's have a look at the Windows Subsystem for Linux, or WSL, today. There's a bunch of videos on YouTube already showing how to get WSL and how to run Kali, or any other Linux, of course, on a Windows 10 or 11 workstation, but things have become much easier than in the early days. We'll see this in a minute. The interesting part for the Kali Linux user, however, will be two things. First, a closer look at the networking, and second, how to integrate everything really seamlessly into the Windows desktop, without any workarounds like KEX or RDP or VNC or the like. Just like you can see it here on my screen, I have the Kali menu bar on top of my Windows desktop. But first, the installation. Oh, and as I said in the last two videos, this video is not about hacking XYZ with Kali Linux. I really think that many of these videos are clickbait. People showing how to crack Wi-Fi or passwords with simplified setups that have nothing to do with real-life scenarios. If you want to have a real introduction into ethical hacking, then please check out the YouTube channel of Offensive Security, or short OFSEC. They are the creators of Kali Linux. The link is up here as well. You might consider taking their courses or certifications. They do have a Discord server as well. Also, check out this video by fellow YouTuber Heath Adams, the Cyber Mentor. It's a 12 hours long course, but nicely sliced into chapters. Have a look, it's really good. Back to WSL2. Installing WSL2 these days is as simple as typing this command in a command shell or PowerShell: wsl --install and optionally -d and the name of the distribution that you want to run. For instance, Debian or Ubuntu, or of course Kali Linux. You do not have to type any other PowerShell commands or the like. That's gone. Alternatively, you can install Debian or Kali Linux or Ubuntu from the Microsoft App Store. Once installed, you can list them with wsl-l-v, which will also show you the version of WSL. We will solely talk about version 2 in this video. What this will also do for you automatically is that it enables two Windows features, namely the virtual machine platform and the Windows subsystem for Linux. Launching a bash shell now is as simple as typing wsl or bash or Ubuntu or Kali Linux. That will all do the same. Start WSL2 and show a terminal running the bash. From here, you can now install all the software that you want. Let's do this similar to what we did in the first episode. I will install kali-desktop-xfce4, and this time let's not use XRDP as a remote access protocol, but rather WinKEX, which is in fact TigerVNC with a nice desktop integration. We'll have a look into another very nice option for Windows 11 later in this video, where we will actually run only the menu bar on the Windows screen. But let's use KEX for starters. Once I type KEX in the bash, it will then ask me for a connection password and also launch the KEX viewer, where I can type that password in. Here we go. Kali running on my Windows desktop. So, cool. So, the first thing that I want to draw your attention to is actually the network setup. I've briefly touched on this in the first two episodes. If we type ip-br-addr in a terminal window inside Kali, then we can see this 172.something address here. And that might be quite surprising to you, because usually your PC probably has a 192.168.something address, right? How come? And what are the implications? The secret is lifted if you go to the network adapter properties on your Windows host. In fact, you can see your Ethernet and or Wi-Fi hardware here. Plus, you may or may not see an additional virtual network adapter called Hyper-V virtual adapter or the like. If you can't see that, then type ipconfig/all in a separate Windows shell and it should show you that. And actually, the MAC address of that adapter is identical to the MAC address inside WSL, which I can show inside WSL with IP link. The reason for this behavior is that WSL2 as such is running inside a virtual machine based on Hyper-V, and that virtual machine has that virtual network adapter attached to it. Network-wise, it actually works as a NATed network behind your host's network interface. Inside that VM, the WSL distributions are running as containers. If you wanted to access the VM or an app running inside Kali from the outside world, then the suggested Microsoft solution is to do a port forwarding or port proxy, like they call it. This needs to be done in PowerShell. Or, hot off the press as of June 2022, you can actually bridge your physical adapter on your host to WSL. That would then behave as if the network was physically attached directly to the container. Here's how to do it. You define a virtual switch using either PowerShell or the Hyper-V console, and then you add the following into a file called .wslconfig into your /users/, then your username, directory on the Windows host. First, you specify networking mode equals bridged, and then you specify the virtual switch saying VM switch equals and then the name of the bridge. At the time of making this video, this is only available in the preview version, but I'd assume that this will go mainstream rather sooner than later. I'll update the description of the video or pin a comment to it. At the moment though, this seems to be work in progress. On a Windows 10, I can actually see two network adapters, Ethernet 0 and Ethernet 1, where Ethernet 1 is the physical adapter. I did not specify the .wslconfig file. Also, there is no Hyper-V switch or on an external adapter. If you want this to work as designed, then as of June 2022, you need the preview version of WSL. Browse to this URL. That will open a Microsoft Store instance from where you can now install the preview version. Next, you need to launch the Hyper-V Manager, then click on Virtual Switch Manager and create a new external virtual switch. I named mine WSL2. Guys, I am not sure if you can actually do that with the home versions of Windows 10 or 11. I don't have a home version to test, unfortunately. Leave me a comment, please. Once you have created that switch and restarted WSL by doing a WSL --shutdown and launching it again, then you should see the physical address if you type IP-BRADDR. Also, now you can launch the tools that need direct network access, like I do here with Wireshark. Seems to be working, it's capturing packets at least. So why would you want to use a physical adapter rather than a virtual one? After all, we can access the internet with a virtual one, can't we? Well, yes. If you wanted to scan your website for vulnerabilities with, let's say, Metasploit, then you can of course do that with any adapter type. But if you wanted to do stuff like I showed in this video here, like analyze network flows of a different device using ARP spoofing, or if you wanted to analyze packets going over a switch on a mirrored port, then you really need a physical adapter. A little side note here. If you want to try out Windows 11 on unsupported hardware without TPM or secure boot, or even run Windows 11 with Hyper-V in a VM running on Linux, KVM, QEMU or in Proxmox, then check out this post on my blog. You can actually do that. It works. You just need Proxmox 7 with a kernel version 5.15 or above. Awesome. That should shed some light on the network aspects of WSL2. Now, let's have a look at how we can nicely integrate the Linux desktop into our Windows environment. You might remember that I have spoken about X11, the Display Manager and the Window Manager in the first episode. As an example, I launched the XEyes application over SSH and it would show up on my Linux box, but not if I did the same thing in Windows 10. With Windows 11, things have changed a bit. And they have changed for the good, actually. Let me show you this. Here's what happens when I launch XEyes in a WSL bash shell on Windows 10. It tells me it has no display, because I don't have a window manager. See what happens if I do the same thing on Windows 11. Ta-da! XEyes opens in a separate window. So, does Windows 11 have an integrated window manager, such as Xorg or Xwayland? Surprisingly, it does not. What you see here is actually an instance of mstsc.exe, the Microsoft Terminal Services client. You can see it here in the Task Manager. When I shut down WSL, it disappears and it reappears when I restart it. But wait, we don't have XRDP running as an endpoint inside WSL, do we? No, we don't. In order to understand this, we need to have a quick look at the WSLG implementation on Windows 11. That subsystem actually runs inside the WSL virtual machine and has the following architecture, which we can find on the WSLG GitHub site. The core of this is a pimped implementation of Weston. Weston is a reference implementation of a Wayland compositor. Wayland, in turn, aims at being the successor to the native X11 implementation. Now, I do not want to go too deep into the tech details here, but there's actually a couple of things that are important to know for us. Even though the window manager, so Wayland and Weston, are not running on the Windows but rather inside the WSL2 VM, Microsoft have actually taught Weston and their terminal service client a couple of new tricks. You can see this FreeRDP running inside the WSL VM. MSTSC connects to that instance from the Windows side and just displays the X11 or Wayland app in a transparent way. And it comes up automatically whenever we launch a GUI app inside WSL. That app would either connect to the X11 display on that X-Wayland process here, or, if it is a Wayland app, connect to the Wayland socket of Weston. How can we leverage that knowledge to actually integrate our kalilinux menus nicely into Windows without adding tools or overhead, such as XRDP, TigerVNC, KEX, X2Go, you name any remote access tool? After all, everything is there, we just need to use it. The thing is, if we would try to just launch an XFCE4 session, for example, in this bash window by typing start XFCE4 or XFCE4-session, then I get an error saying that it has problems accessing the Wayland display. Now, if we look at the environment variables, then we see this Wayland underscore display setting here. If I wanted XFCE4 to go through the X11 display, then all I'd have to do is actually set this variable to an empty value. Like this. If I now launch start XFCE4 again, then the session comes up. It shows the XFCE4 menu panel, and they do contain all the Kali menu items. But we do get a lot of error messages here. That's mainly because a full session tries to do a lot of things, such as provide communications between the windows and processes, launch audio and so on. But honestly, I don't really need all that. I just want that menu bar on top of my screen. So let me interrupt this with Ctrl-C. If we look at the screen layout of a typical X desktop session, then usually we have the menu bar on top, we have a background on the desktop, and maybe additional items such as widgets and panels, etc. And in X11 terms, each one of those is a separate window. That means that the top panel that contains the menu shortcuts is just a window that the Wayland/Weston/RDP combination should show on my desktop. I can actually do that by just typing XFCE4-panel. And yes, we already get fewer errors, but the visible result is pretty much the same. On the first launch, the panel might show up on a different screen or in the middle of the screen. So what you can do is either do a right click and select the preferences here, or open a separate WSL shell and type XFCE4-panel /P. That opens the properties window here, where I can actually do stuff like unlock the panel so that I could move it or select the display and so on. Once it has stored those parameters, it comes up okay on the next launch. Awesome! Last but not least, I would want this to happen automatically if I start up WSL. So what I can do is that I just add this line to the .bashrc file in my home directory. Kind of the poor man's service auto run, really. But it does the trick. I'll set the Wayland display to an empty value, launch XFCE-panel in the background, that's what the ampersand is good for, and I just pipe error messages to Nirvana so that I don't see them. Let's test. WSL --shutdown, then start it again, takes a while, and here we go, menu bar, beautiful. I can launch all apps, the menu is just nicely present, but otherwise I can work with my window, like I used to do before. That's really transparent, perfect. Guys, that concludes today's episode. Please let me know if you liked it. If so, a like on YouTube is much appreciated. Please do leave me a comment on YouTube. Many thanks for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.